Right, we're ready to go. So,
hi everyone. So this paper presents some preliminary exploration, I do emphasize it is preliminary, into the construction of narrative or narrativity in electroacoustic and sound artworks, with a focus on those exhibit attributes of techno-nostalgia, which is often shortened to technostalgia. After identifying key aspects of the technostalgia movement in sound, I'll approach three sound works in order to identify how narrative aspects might be communicated to the listener through sonic and or transmedia references. And it's proposed that by activating personal and collective memories of sights and rituals of listening, the sound works are informed by technostalgia, particularly those that incorporate intermedia, offer rich potential in terms of narrativity. So in recent years, both mainstream and experimental electronic composers have looked to obsolete sound technologies as sources of composition material or as conceptual starting points. And in doing so, many artists have contributed to what Shrey calls a golden age of nostalgia for past media technologies. Indeed, Claire Bishop writes that today, no exhibition is complete without some form of bulky, obsolete technology. I'm not entirely sure if that's completely true, but I have seen quite a few exhibitions with the technology on stage. Often artists find themselves re-engaging with forgotten sound materials or reconnecting with the manipulation of material objects in response to what is often thought of as a clinical digital aesthetic, a sort of aesthetic of perfectionism. This form of escapism from the digital world, although to be honest it's very rarely complete escapism, generates numerous aesthetic questions related to materiality, temporality, listening behaviours, memory, the fetishization of technology, and the actuation of false versions of things like nostalgia. So the potency of nostalgia in media is widely recognised. For experimental artists, the turntable in particular has become a focal point, as heard in Ian Armstrong's Dirty Grooves, Elke Parmerud's similarly titled Grooves, or many of the installation works by Yannick Schaefer, and we saw an example in the previous slide. And many artists can be seen to be subverting and preparing the turntable as objects, essentially creating an experimental instrument in its own right, as demonstrated by artists like Maria Chavez, Emil Schick, Graham Dunning, Christian Martin, etc. However, despite the dominance of the turntable and vinyl, many other obsolete technologies are increasingly making their way into composers' and sound artists' toolkits, a trend identified by Weisenbrunner. Examples include the quarter-inch tape manipulations in Yves Dove's work About Time, Alex Kolkowski's experiments in mechanical acoustic music, and the installation works of Stephen Cornfold featuring cassette players. Such ontological exploration of recording and playback technologies is recognised as evoking nostalgia for composers and audiences alike through its ability to manipulate collective memory of time and place. And this is recognised by Campofiano in his article on technostalgia. It's this potential of nostalgia to evoke time and place beyond the actual presentation environment that's of particular interest to me when considering narrativity in sound art. So before analysing how narrativity might be constructed in sound art, it's useful to identify some key conditions of narrativity. And I'm quoting Marie-Laure Ryan here, although there's plenty of literature available on sort of conditions for narrativity, and there's quite a lot of debate as well around these. But essentially we've got the construction of an image of a world populated with individuated agents or characters, not fully predictable changes of state that occur within this world, and the relationship between physical events and mental state, if it essentially creating some kind of plot within the art. It's widely recognised that the potential for narrative construction of music alone may be limited by music's self-referential status. However, writers Kalinos and Tarski acknowledge the multitude of relations between music and narrative and the way in which structures might not necessarily tell stories, but may enable us to associate with the stories. As such, music can possess narrativity without necessarily being a narrative. But both Kalinos and Tarski are discussing traditional music focused on pitch relationships. When we invite sound into this discourse, there's a potential to signify real-world elements through a process of source bonding. Narrative relies on representation, and sound is well equipped to project references to concrete objects, time, and places. And this capacity is critical in stimulating narrative content by A, establishing an environment, B, constructing a sense of agency, evolving the scene, as required by Ryan's narratological criteria. Arguably, the transmedial nature of much sound art, where visual, spatial, sculptural, or interactive elements combine with the sonic aspects, contributes further to this process by reinforcing, clarifying, or enhancing implied sonic narratives. So returning to Mary Lord Ryan, she identifies how narrative might be put into play. But something we also have to consider is that it's important to avoid being in this endless loop of maybe this is narrative, maybe this is narrative, and so on. And so she said it's only when all of these processes come together and form a reasonably stable mental image that they generate representations that fulfill all the conditions for a narrative. So in each of the following works, I'll attempt to identify stimuli that may trigger the construction of narrativity, and in doing so, I hope to offer a provisional approach to understanding sense-making in technostalgic sound work. I propose that the listener's recognition of sites and rituals of past listening in particular plays a critical role in activating narrativity. So Lowenthal said in 1985, we crave evidence that the past endures in recoverable form, some agency, some mechanism, some faith will enable us not just to know it, but to see it and feel it. And this is a starting point for a recent work of mine called Rewind. Rewind is a 5.1 electroacoustic work which uses the operational sounds of vintage and obsolete recording machinery as its primary source material. The material was recorded with kind assistance from the British Library, who granted me access to all of their archive of recording devices at King's Cross, although they have plenty of others in Yorkshire. The devices I recorded ranged from wax cylinders, wire recorders, through to more recent technologies such as vinyl, tape, cassette, compact disc, and mini disc. I chose not to focus on the playback of sound recordings stored in a different media, but instead the operational sounds of the technology, the sort of sonic byproducts of mechanisms like dials, switches, reels, winding, and also the evidence of technological mediation brought about during playback, such as noise, hiss, and crackle. So by and incidental sounds of recording devices as musical material, the composition seeks to explore metanoise, which is a term coined by Greg Hange, as a fundamental compositional tool. And something I was very interested in addition to these ideas of noise and glitch and how the sounds would relate to a sort of socio-technological history, whether that's real or imagined, was this idea of media archaeology and how by being a sort of archaeologist with these sounds, I was presenting something from the past which might not be known to some people but was within living memory for others. So to listen to media archaeologically is to pay attention to the electronic message of the acoustic apparatus, not primarily to its musical content, its cultural meaning. That's something that really sort of drove this particular work. And Wolfgang Ernst notes that listening in this way opens up our ears to the cultural technological. And in doing so, what can these sounds tell us about our historical experience and our current ways of engaging with music playback? And the raw exposure of the material facilitating mechanisms of listening to music that's historically, culturally, and musically significant. It becomes particularly intriguing when you compare it to the way in which we tend to engage with music nowadays, our sort of contemporary music consumption behaviours, which tends to be silent. And I thought that sort of juxtaposition, because essentially this is a digital work, but it's drawing upon an age of dealing in a haptic way with analogue technology. So in many ways, this particular compositional project stems from my own personal realisation that much contemporary consumption of music is via digital devices, which produce reduced haptic feedback for the user. Increasingly, the discrete click of a mouse or the silent swipe of a touch screen initiates playback of a pristine digital replica of a musical track. As such, a tactile user experiencing audio playback and the associated variety of rich sounds have almost completely been erased. Not only has labour been removed from the production of a work through the technology of recording, as discussed by Atali, but increasingly any trace of labour and the activity of playback, whether by the human or machine, is also being rubbed away. So in illuminating the tactile interactions with this equipment, the work revisits the rituals associated with tangible material sound formats. Many of the sounds evoked are evoked through a process of anamnesis, which is a kind of reminder of a time far away from the present. And the performative act of playback along with its theatre of props is sort of evoked in the listener's imagination. This may be a kind of fake nostalgia, so something that we haven't actually had lived experience of, or it can be an authentic nostalgia, something that we have had experience of. Either way, it doesn't really matter, it's a stimulus for generating a sense of narrative. And Neumayer talks about this idea of media activating, framing, and rendering memory shareable, and that really underpins the whole kind of ethos of this work. Although we might not all have owned a record player at some time, most of us will be familiar with the process of putting on a record. Many of us might remember creating mixtapes using cassettes. Many of us may remember the telltale sounds of CDs loading before playback, etc. These sounds evoke situations, routines, and for many of us, memories of participating in what can be thought of as rituals of consumption. And that term, rituals of consumption, is borrowed from Grant McCracken. There is an issue, though, with some of the older playback devices, where perhaps personal memory cannot be recalled, and collective memory is somewhat out of reach. For instance, when was the last time anyone had worked a wire recorder? Probably a very, very long time ago. So we moved from more recent technologies through to the very earliest, constructing a path towards these more distant technologies for the listener. And that's how the work is structured. So the journey, while technically oral, is intended to be a multimodal experience. It tends to generate a sensation of touch and the listener's contact with sound or gestalt force. These are critical elements within the work. Listeners are encouraged to recall or imagine their own interactions or the manipulation of sounds. It sort of acts as a bridge between the reality of touch and imagined or recalled memory. Nonetheless, narrative identity is somewhat ambiguous in this work. The listener is given a scenario which permits access to forgotten sites and rituals of listening, but the specifics of that encounter are not guaranteed. Being a designed linear temporal form, narrative here is closely aligned to that particular structure. But at the same time, gestures can be quite informative, providing a sense of agency, perhaps related back to our criteria of narrative. Even if there's not a defined protagonist in the traditional sense, the listener is encouraged to identify with gestures as possible instigators. So I'm going to move on now to another work, which is, actually I'll play a little bit of your mind, that would make a bit more sense. So this is just an introduction from the opening of the work, that's in a stereo mix. Thank you. And in recording and researching a lot of materials for Rewind, I started to look for people who were working in a similar way with these sorts of past recording devices, obsolete recording devices. And I actually met Stephen at a conference and started discussing some of his work with him. And I'll play you a little identifying the ubiquity of the analogue audio cassettes and the icon on t-shirts, tote bags, smartphone covers, etc. But in Binatone Galaxy, the presentation of these devices is somewhat more profound. In Cornford's installation, around 30 cassette players are attached to the walls, creating a sculptural web of individual mechanisms, each with their own signature playback qualities. But this multi-channel installation inhabits not just the gallery space. It invites a spatio-temporal reading that draws upon technostalgia by stimulating memory which is either personal, collective, or for some even mythical. The intimate foregrounding of parasitic sounds, as is found in Rewind, alongside the presentation of the object's mechanisms as museum pieces, invites the construction of narrative around the real or imagined memory of these devices. It provokes questions such as who instigated the playback of each of these devices? Who owned this device? What was it used for? In what situation? For many listeners, this installation will stimulate memories of mixtapes, popular music, and the associated sites of those creative activities. As such, there may be two parallel narratives of a specific personal memory and also of the collective remembered. And I'm going to move on very, very quickly to my second other work, which is Twinkle by Andrea Byrne. And this takes the idea of narrativity one step further. By actually asking the listener to engage in a practice of listening that has now been lost. And that's the practice of listening in a record booth from a record shop in the 1960s. Again, I'll tell you a very short example. This work was inspired by the 60s female singer Twinkle, and it's set up with an original 1960s record booth, but not actually playing back. So you don't see any movement of that booth. But the booth is decorated with sparkles, and the listener is encouraged to actually approach and engage in a listening experience, which has now been lost, in order to evoke this particular tale, this particular narrative about Twinkle. Transmedia work evokes the purple aura of the past, and although there is not defined evolution of the sound world over the time as such, in the way that we find in a through composed acousmatic work, the work is able to convey narrative elements. A sculptural form, a decorated 1960s record shop booth, reinforces the underlying narrative elements, the transience of fame, the tarnishing of youth through commodification, and the focus on an individual, in this case Twinkle, conjures up strong images of a specific narrative. So in conclusion, all three works explore in this paper display elements of hypermediacy, where media elements are deliberately highlighted or exaggerated, and in doing so, elements of agency, temporality, intimacy, and socio-cultural or socio-technological change may be brought to the fore. But despite the potency of the situations that are presented to a listener, the unfolding of events and constructed plot may be deeply embedded. And so in all three works, that many aspects of narrative are indeterminate, although less so in Twinkle. So I've just scratched the surface of the field of narratology and transmedia storytelling, However, based on this preliminary study, there seems potential, particularly where sound references the past or past objects, to at least analyse the production narrativity, if not narrative.